Allo, allo, Emilio?
Allo, allo, allo.
Emiliuccio, come stai?
Here we are. Hello, Geppi.
Are you okay?
Where is your background?
Well, I decided to remove this this background because, I mean, I had problems with the lights and so on. So this one is a little bit better.
But promise me that you will bring it back next week. Come on.
Okay.
Bring your background back.
Well, this is yours is very nice, let me tell you. Eh?
Yeah,
very nice.
So. It's like a network.
Yes, it's like it's really like a network. It looks like real, you know? Very nice. Hello, guys. Already 150 people with us today for the happy hour. Dermoscopy happy hour means that we spent 1 hour together, you know, chatting, drinking, and having fun around dermoscopy. What is the theme of today, Emilio?
The theme of today is one of our favorite themes.
Yeah.
Nails.
It's, wow, nails is nice. Yeah, and we will have a very super nice guest. By the way, should we say who is the guest?
I think so because our social media guys already revealed it in social media, so we can.
Yeah,
we can say.
We have Michela Starace from Bologna. She is a super passionate and expert. Trichoscopist and nailoscopist.
So after so many years, do you finally feel confident to examine nails?
Well, maybe we can ask the question to our friends. Don't you think so?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Let's go with the question of the week.
The question of the week. So what is the... So, by the way, before the question of the week, should we do something unexpected?
Of course. Yes.
Should we invite Sebastiano finally to show up in the show?
Of course, our producer, our production manager, here he is.
Sebi, you are so beautiful.
Come on, you're wonderful. So, guys, Sebastiano Pellerone exists. That's the first.
Yes.
He's a real person.
Yes, he's taking care of everything in the background. Of course, he's not only taking care of the Moscopy Happy Hour, but he's doing a very good job with us in Naples as a resident in dermatology. And therefore, he will become a super dermatologist.
But now, of course, now that there will be, you know, a fight. Inside him, because this new career as a film producer and show producer will be very, you know.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
It could be. But Ben, Steffi, don't you think that it's a good idea to launch the question of the week?
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Let's start with the question of the week. Okay, do you use dermoscopy for nail diseases? Yes, no, sometimes. Emilio,
finally.
Sometimes. Yeah.
Last week, in your question of the week, you did not include sometimes as an option, and I was very much upset. I mean, come on. Sometimes should always be there. And of course, is 99% of the times is the winner.
Winner, yeah. We like the sometimes option.
Yeah.
Let's see. Let's see how things are going. Let's, by the way, we have 200 people already collected.
Yes.
By far the winner. 73%. 73%.
So wow. People use dermoscopy for nail diseases. But to be honest, I mean, is there any kind of skin disease for which we don't use dermoscopy today?
This is a good question. I would say basically none, because whenever I visit a patient, I have my dermatoscope in my hand. So it's definitely very hard to say. No, but for nail diseases, let me tell you, in the last few years, I learned a lot and I improved a lot my chance to to perform better diagnosis. Maybe you like to go to the paper of the week.
Yeah, sure. We will go to the paper of the week. But just to continue what you said, maybe the most challenging part concerning nail diseases is not the one that we will discuss today. We will discuss today mainly about pigmented nail bands. The even more challenging topic is non-pigmented nail disorders. And of course, in one of the next episodes, this is something that we will speak about, because also there we have learned quite a lot of things during the last years.
Yeah.
And we understood that not everything is a fungal infection. Eh?
Exactly. As our friend Luc Thomas from Lyon, who was, by the way, will be, by the way, one of our guests, is always saying onychomycosis is an invention. You know? Doesn't exist. But yeah, you said correctly, not only nowadays we have improved the differential diagnosis of pigmented nail bands, but also in the context of non-pigmented tumors of the nails, we improved, and we will speak a little bit about it. Of course, there is the third, let's say, big field, which is nail involvement in the context of inflammatory skin conditions. And this is, by the way, maybe still the most difficult area where we have to improve.
Definitely. Okay, let's go with the paper of the week. Sebi, should I wait for of course.
Yes.
Very good. So, paper of the week. Sebi, please allow me to share my screen. Okay, there we go.
Okay, what are you going to show us?
I am going first to show you, to remind you that in the end we have our game, quiz game. And you can, in order to play, you will need to use your smartphones and visit www.kahoot.it. And then you will be asked to enter a pin. The pin was already in the home screen, and we will repeat the pin immediately before the game in the end. So, paper of the week for this year, for this week, comes from which journal? That's a big surprise.
Should I guess? Dermatology Practical and Conceptual?
You are so good.
Nice. So good.
The Red Journal.
Yes, the Red Journal.
The Red Journal. Do you like it?
Yeah, I like it, the Red Journal. Yeah, ah, nice.
The Red Journal, it's nice. It's
yeah.
Nice. Maybe we will keep it.
Yeah.
Good. And it comes from Miki Alastaracci and the group of Bologna, Aurora, Alessandrini, Niccolò Brandi, and Bianca Maria, of course, Piracini, about the use of nail dermoscopy in management of melanonychia. This was basically a review paper, but what I like very much is that the proposed approach that I will show you shortly now. Before this, let's play a little bit with the audience a little bit more. So here you can see a case of a pigmented nail band, and this is dermoscopy of the band. So now let's launch my question, Sebi. Before speaking about the paper, let's just see how the audience would react. So, simple question. Do you think it's benign or suspicious? Or
sometimes.
Sometimes. Depends. Oh, a D is missing. Depends is wrong, of course. It should be depends.
Depends.
I can predict that.
You see, you know why? Because you didn't mention the age of the patient. By the way, it was clear from the clinical, but.
It was clear from the clinical, and also this is included in the depends answer.
Exactly.
Because this was meant to be the third answer, depends on the age. Of course. Sebi, please remove the poll. Of course, it's clear that the morphology is very suspicious dermatoscopically and clinically. There is no doubt. But as we will discuss in a minute, the age plays a huge role in the evaluation of pigmented nail bands. So in the paper, Michela proposes three steps on what we should do each time we see a pigmented nail band. The first is to try to decide if this pigment corresponds to melanin or not. And this is very important, of course. More frequently, it will not correspond to melanin. Reasonable. Then, if it does not correspond to melanin, then this is the end of the story. We don't go to steps two and three. But if it corresponds to melanin, then we go to step two, which is to try to decide if this is a melanocytic activation or a real melanocytic proliferation, so a melanocytic tumor. And then, if it's a melanocytic activation, end of the story. If it's a melanocytic proliferation, we go to step three, which is to decide if the lesion is benign or malignant. So concerning step one, obviously the most frequent cause of nail pigmentation is hemorrhage, subbangual hemorrhage. And obviously, usually the hemorrhage is easy to recognize because it's red. But another point that I would like to highlight, and also Michela highlights in the paper, extremely useful clue, is the fact that the hemorrhage very frequently does not arise from the proximal nail fold. And when the band does not arise from the proximal nail fold, this excludes immediately nevi and melanoma. And here is the image from the paper. You can see this pigmented nail band, which is somehow strange and could be considered as suspicious because it's black and irregular. But you can see here that it clearly does not originate from the proximal nail fold. This is enough to exclude melanoma, because melanoma of the nail unit always originates, is located in the nail matrix, and therefore the band should originate from the proximal nail fold. So this is the first thing. Then the second cause of pigmentation in the nails might be microorganisms, fungi. They exist, you know, sometimes.
Just a little bit.
Yeah. And of course, Trichophyton rubrum might occasionally result to a pigmentation of the nail plate, and green color usually corresponding to Pseudomonas is also another possibility. But of course, here again, you can see that the band does not originate from the proximal nail fold. So this is a really, really useful clue to remember. Then, if we go to the second step, in order to decide if this is a melanocytic activation or proliferation, we have to answer a couple of questions. First, if only one nail is involved, or if many nails are involved. Because if many nails are involved, then obviously we can immediately exclude melanocytic proliferations. We can immediately exclude tumors and think about a systemic cause, such as the use of drugs or pigment because of the ethnicity or some rare syndromes. So the number of nails is obviously a very important clue. And this is again a photograph from the paper showing a picture of melanocytic activation because of chemotherapy. So a drug that causes this nail pigmentation, which affects, of course, multiple nails and not only one. Then another clue to decide if this is a proliferation of or an activation is the color of the band itself. Because in melanocytic tumors, nevi and melanoma, the color of the band is really brown, either light brown or more frequently dark brown. In contrast, in melanocytic activation, the color is not really brown. It's rather a gray background color, and here is an example of a band which is not really brown under dermoscopy. The color here is rather gray, and again, this excludes excludes, I mean, not excludes, but this makes the possibility of a melanocytic tumor very unlikely, very unlikely. And finally, the third step to decide if the pigmentation, if we decide in step two that it is a proliferation, that it is a tumor, then to decide if it's benign or malignant, we have to consider the following three very important issues. First, by far, is the age. And Michela in their paper underlined it with emphasis that the age is extremely important, in which sense, especially in the sense that in childhood, these rules do not work. In childhood, congenital nevi are very frequently ugly. They are looking like melanomas. They acquire melanoma criteria. Therefore, such as the one we saw earlier. Okay, of course, it's a large nail band, irregular nail band. So even a little bit of pigmentation in the periangual skin. So everything is suspicious, with the exception of the age, because the age was 6 years old. And the scenario of melanoma of the nail plate in childhood is extremely rare. Did you ever, JP, had the case of a melanoma of the nail?
No way.
Michela in their paper, we will ask her later, mentioned that in the literature there are overall 20 cases of reported melanomas in childhood, but we will have the chance later to ask her in which age precisely these melanomas were described. So epidemiology here helps us a lot. The second thing, which is very important, is the size of the band. So we didn't yet go to dermoscopy. We spoke about the age, and now we speak about the size of the nail band. This is also a very important clue. Of course, not in childhood, in adulthood. This is a very important clue. And this is, by the way, a paper that Michela mentions in her article. This was a study by you, JP, and a group of collaborators, in which you found that the size of the band itself is already a very important clue, at least in the sense of the wide bands. So if we see a band covering more than two-thirds of the nail plate, this is a very, very suspicious clue, even if the lesion is not extremely asymmetric. For instance, this is a pigmented nail band. It covers almost all the surface of the nail plate. It's not terribly asymmetric from a dermatoscopic aspect, but it's too large. And this is already suspicious. So size is very important. And finally, of course, we have to assess if the band is regular, consisting of lines of the same color and the same thickness, or irregular. And definitely, this is the third point we should take into account. So, last thing, of course, is the micro-Hutchinson sign, which is highlighted by dermoscopy. And as Michela mentioned, this is particularly helpful in the rare cases of amelanotic melanoma of the nail nail unit. And here they show in the paper again an example in which dermoscopy reveals an ulcerated lesion with an unspecific morphology, obviously, but also reveals this micro-Hutchinson sign, so the presence of pigmentation in the periangual skin. So definitely, this is something we should keep in mind. Okay, that was it.
Very good.
Do you like these three steps? That
I like it very much. I like it very much. But I also have a couple of cases really remarking a little bit what you said. There is a question: best treatment of green nails. Do you have a best treatment
For Pseudomonas?
Yes, Pseudomonas. Yeah.
Antibiotics for Pseudomonas.
Yes. Topical, in my view, because this is really a localized disease. So I don't think it's already enough to use gentamicin or...
That depends, of course, also on the general scenario.
Situation, yeah. Okay, there is also another comment. I don't agree in the fact that saying that proximal nail fold is not reached by blood in serious trauma. Yes, of course. Yeah,
of course.
Trauma is definitely reached. Yeah, you're right.
It's vice versa.
Yeah,
the blood, of course, occasionally might reach the proximal nail fold. The point is that if the band you see does not arise from the proximal nail fold, then you can exclude melanoma.
Melanoma is excluded. That's the point, you know, because sometimes I see some patients coming with nail subungual hemorrhages, very scared by doctors who might think that this could be melanoma, but the fact that this band is not reaching the proximal nail fold is excluding, by definition, the diagnosis. Well, there are some colleagues reporting to have seen sometimes melanoma of the nail bed. But this is, you know, again, a very extremely rare occasions. It's extremely rare situation. So, you know, we cannot change our mind just because of one or two cases happening all around the world.
Of course, that's always the case. I mean, we often use the words
never. Never.
Always.
Yes.
The word exclude, the word 100%.
Yes.
This is obviously always an exaggeration.
There is
nothing for which you can say 100%. There are always extreme scenarios. There are always exceptions. But we don't base our management on exceptions. We base our management on the rules and on the big probabilities.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. There are also other. I see that the topic is quite interesting. Pseudo Hutchinson sign. Yeah, a pseudo Hutchinson sign is the fact that you see a pigment underneath the skin of the cuticula. So this is not a real Hutchinson, because a real Hutchinson means that the skin is pigmented. You know,
dermoscopy helps a lot to understand that this is not a real pigmentation of the skin.
Yeah, exactly. What about if the band is getting darker or increasing in size in a child? Well, usually we expect the opposite. In a child, usually we expect that the lesion is fading away in some way. Of course, if there is an increase of the pigment, then of course we have to, keep an eye and be more cautious. But this is never happening in some way. Yeah.
But in general, to try to answer the question, so is there any scenario in which in a child you would be worried and prompt to biopsy the lesion? Can we try to answer this question? Okay, we say, don't worry if the band is large. Don't worry if the band is asymmetric. Don't worry if you see Hutchinson sign. Don't worry in any scenario.
Yeah.
Or is there any scenario in which you worry in a child?
I never experienced myself any situations in which I had to worry.
Yeah.
Well, I worried a lot. I did biopsies
in the past
of congenital nevi with Hutchinson sign and so on. But nowadays, I don't do it anymore. Yeah.
There is a very nice comment in the Q&A by Verze. Hi, Verze. That there is the probability, of course, there is the probability that you have an hemorrhage, but there is also a melanoma.
Yes.
The hemorrhage might be a sign of advanced melanoma, or it also might be random. That's a very good point. So when we see an hemorrhage on the nail plate, it's a good idea to monitor the fact that the hemorrhage will disappear, and then afterwards you will be able to check again and see that there is nothing hidden by the hemorrhage. That's a very good point. A question concerning biopsy: if you consider the lesion as suspicious, do you prefer punch or distolateral biopsy? JP, you like to take it?
Yes, this is a very important question, by the way, because we recently experienced the case of a lesion recurring after partial biopsy, and the partial biopsy was negative, so it was a nevus. But since the lesion originally was very ugly looking, we didn't feel confident to leave it there, and we excised the lesion entirely. So, if it's possible, in my view, it's better to excise the lesion entirely if it's a small band. If it's a very large band, of course, it's not easy. And then if it's a large band, most probably it's a melanoma, you know, and therefore.
Just specify that when you say excise the lesion, you mean excise the lesion on the matrix.
On the matrix, of course.
Not the melanonychia. We don't care about the band. We care about the lesion of the matrix.
Exactly. Yeah. So usually we never do, exceptionally we do punch biopsies. We always do partial onychectomy. So it means that we excise a part of the nail apparatus, including matrix, nail and nail bed. You know, and then we put stitches in order to.
A lot of questions come.
Yes.
But I would say, Jeppy, you go with your cases because they are on the same topic, and we discuss the questions together with Michela because.
Yes, exactly. This is a good idea. This is a good idea because, of course, we need also Michela to answer all these questions. Yes, I like really to to underline a few of the topics you raised by these four cases, okay? I prepared just four cases. One case is this one, okay? This is the lesion. This is what you can see morphologically. And I don't want to say anything, but I want you to vote. Maybe you can, what to do, biopsy, follow-up, depend on patient age. Exactly the same question you did at the beginning. Okay, so let's see. Maybe I can show you again the case in the meanwhile. This is the case.
Yeah, I think that we discussed already quite a lot about it, so I guess the answer will be...
Yeah. So depend on patient age, this is definitely the winner. And the patient age is not the same as you showed before, because this is a 35-year-old patient, and therefore the lesion was excised, and by the way, diagnosed as a nevus. So why we decided to excise it? Because of the age, of course, because of the size of the lesion, because the size of the lesion is less than one third of the nail plate. So usually this is within the range of a benign lesion, not really suspicious. But what was the reason was especially the irregularity. As you can see here, there are three bands which are starting from the proximal nail fold, which are more dark and with hypopigmented intervals, you see. So the band was quite irregular, okay? And therefore, we decided to biopsy immediately, but also, you know, follow-up
would be...
Yes, it's also a good option in my view. It's also a good option because, I mean, in these particular instances, we also have to remind two things. First of all, doing a biopsy of the nail matrix is not a nice thing for the patient, and it will definitely leave a scar forever. Okay, a nail dystrophy forever. So we cannot do it, you know, just you know. With a very superficial mind. We have to have good reasons. And secondly, if you perform a biopsy too early, it could be possible that you don't get the diagnosis by the pathologist, because also melanoma, early melanoma, it could be difficult for the pathologist as it is for the clinician. Okay, so it's always a good idea to make a follow-up. In this case, we didn't, but it's a very good option. And in the majority of cases, that's what we do. So to recall the three scenarios we have. The first scenario is a child with a pigmented nail bend. We don't care. We just follow up. And then we have two scenarios concerning adults. Adults with small and regular pigmented nail bends, then we do a follow-up. But we have to do it at least for a couple of years. And then the third scenario is the one with an adult patient with a large bend, independently if the bend is regular or irregular, and or irregularity of the bend. In this case, there is a chance it could be melanoma. So either we do a very short-term follow-up, but in my view, it's more safe to perform a biopsy. Okay? So, but this is what we have concerning pigmented nail bends. Now, for a moment, I would like to concentrate a little bit about the second issue, which is non-pigmented tumors of the nail matrix. Okay? Here it is, a case. And you can see the morphology, clinical endoscopy, and here the choices. What should we do? We have to biopsy, follow up, or no action? Send the patient home.
This is one of the things that we learned in the last years. So now I feel quite confident about the diagnosis here. Why 3-4 years ago, I don't remember. I would feel,
Yes, but I can give you also another clue, which is this one.
Also, of course.
Okay, follow-up is the majority, but still 24% say biopsy and 35% say no action, which is good, by the way. So what is the very, very good news about non-pigmented tumors is the fact that we learned a lot in the last few years. Why are we interested in non-pigmented nail bends? Because melanoma is not the only cancer of the nails. We have another cancer, which is squamous cell carcinoma. That's why we are interested in this kind of benign things. Okay, and there are two, three most frequent benign tumors. One of these is onychopapilloma, and this is a case where we have all the features. It's a red nail bend. Usually, it's small. There are splinter hemorrhages, which is a very typical finding, and there is this kind of triangular shape at the distal portion of the lesion. Can you see it, Emilio?
Of course I can. Show it in your with your mouse.
Yes. Can you see my mouse?
Yes.
Triangular shape of this kind of onycholysis. Exactly. And also, if we are lucky, like in this case, we have hyperkeratosis at the free edge of the nail. Okay? So this is typical for onychopapilloma. What to do? Follow up. Because there is a small proportion, there is a very nice paper from the king of nails, which is Baran, and he published 35 cases of onychopapilloma, and he said in just 3 cases, the same morphology was seen in a squamous cell carcinoma in situ of the nail matrix.
At the very beginning,
exactly. But we have to remember that squamous cell carcinoma, in the great majority of cases, is not starting from the nail matrix, is starting from the nail bed or the periungual area. Okay, so just a minority starts in the nail matrix. Now, case number 3 is this one. Look, how nice is this? Again, a bend.
I would like to see the free edge.
Yeah, I don't have the free edge. I'm sorry. I don't have the free edge, but in my view, we can still do the diagnosis. This is a larger bend, whiter, a little bit yellow. Maybe, Sebi, you can launch the poll. Again, biopsy, follow-up, or no action. Okay.
But I think that even from this image, you can guess how the free edge will be.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So let's see the result of the poll. Okay, follow-up 46, biopsy 37. So biopsy is increasing. Why? Because it's a larger lesion. And so I definitely agree with you that this is a more a lesion we have to be more cautious. By the way, there are clues. I mean, Emilio, you understood what it is.
Onychomatricoma.
Onychomatricoma, exactly. I mean, the lesion was not biopsied. So this is our thought. Eh? It's a clinical diagnosis for the moment. Of course, we are performing a follow-up. This is a recent case, but it's a young patient. And it's a long-standing lesion. Starting from the matrix, is producing a kind of white leukonychia, so white and yellow band. And if you look at the free edge, you will see this kind of tubular structures that you can imagine are seen here on the horizontal level, on its horizontal layer. This is extremely nice. Huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Onychomatricoma, again, is one of these, let's say, more common benign tumors of the nail band, of the nail matrix. Third case I want to show you is this one. You see, is again erythronychia. So it's a red band, much larger than the previous case. And here the options: biopsy, follow up, or before doing this, ask a question before deciding. Ask a question.
Any question.
Any question. How are you? What are you doing tonight?
Or you can either ask a question or you can try to check. You can do a specific action.
Action, yeah.
Without exactly. Asking anything, you just do it and then you understand.
Yeah. Yeah, ask a question before deciding. Yeah, very nice. Okay, and what question you would like to ask, Emilio?
If it's painful or not, or you
if
can
it's
check.
Painful. You can check it. Yeah. Yeah, but we can check it by ourselves. But anyway, we asked, and the lesion is reported to be painful, and therefore the most probable diagnosis was is a glomus tumor. By the way, we did a biopsy. No, we didn't do a biopsy. We excised the lesion because it's painful, so we have to do it because it's causing problems to the patient, and of course the histopathology confirmed the diagnosis. So this was this is just the very recent cases of the three most common benign tumors of the nail matrix: onychopapilloma, onychomatricoma, and glomus tumor. But remember, this is the most important thing, is that squamous cell carcinoma mostly begins at the in the subungual area and at the nail, in the nail bed. So the main differential diagnosis is not these three lesions, but it's wart.
It's warts, yeah.
Yeah, onychomycosis. Pyogenic granuloma sometimes, you know. So, you know, we have to be cautious. We have to remember the possibility, even if it's rare, of squamous cell carcinoma of the nail.
Okay, good. Very good. We have a lot of questions, but let's let Michela in.
Yes, Michela, we need you.
We need you so much.
I did a mistake because I didn't send Michela the link. So she was, hello, Michela. Ciao.
Hi, Michela. Ciao.
Hi.
Thanks for joining.
Ciao.
Michela, we were mentioning you since the beginning, but you cannot hear because I didn't send you the link. So...
Yes, so I didn't know if I have to connect before or after, because your message say alpha and seven, so I'm waiting.
No, theoretically, the guests connect a little bit afterwards, but today, if we knew how many questions we're going to receive, we would connect with you from the beginning, yes. Because who can answer these questions
better
than you?
It's a pleasure to be the beginning, but unfortunately, it was impossible, but it's okay. I heard everything after my connection, and yeah. I saw some question.
But it's very nice to see that males are very catching, you know, for dermatologists, you know, we always have we get a lot of questions concerning nails. But Emilio, maybe you gave a.
I lost.
I also lost. So we lost Jeffrey. But okay.
What about melanoma in dark skin people with ethnic melanonychia? Yeah, Michela, how many melanomas in dark skin type did you see?
Until now, the literature is published that we have 12 melanoma in general, published until now. In Caucasian, so in my population, only two. Mm-hmm. So usually nail melanoma is evident only in Asiatic person, especially in Japanese. This is the special. So if you have a melanonychia, a specific melanonychia in some type of people, you have to excise or you have to perform a longitudinal biopsy. And in any cases, because the suspect is very high.
Yeah.
And you know, the criteria in these skin types are different. In these skin types, in Asian populations and in dark skin, the criteria are different or the same?
No, the criteria is similar. The real problem is the age. So in children, in Asiatic, is more frequent to have melanoma. In adult, it's the same for all the world. It's not different. There are a lot of melanoma in all different parts of the world. So the problem is that you have to follow four steps. So first of all, the real role of dermoscopy is to distinguish if your pigmentation is melanic or not. This is the only role of real role of onychoscopy. If you know that is a melanic pigmentation, you have to understand, first of all, how many digits are involved. If there are multiple digits, it's okay. It's a benign. It's not a problem. If you have only one digit, you have to understand the age. If it's a children, okay, you have to follow up. The only two reasons to biopsy in a child melanonychia, is the time of the onset and the difference of the color and the shape and the size of the band in a very short time.
What do you mean?
So if the band change in color or in a dimension, in 1-2 months in a child, you have to biopsy immediately. It's the only question that you have to talk with the parents. On the other is the anxious of the parents, but you have to follow up the child every 6 months in the first year and then every year.
Michela, how many melanomas before the age of 14 did you see in your life?
Two.
Of the nail?
Of the nail, two in children, two, only two. Mm. 12 in the world and two in Caucasian. And one is really is not a Caucasian because this child is come from Argentina, but okay. She live in Italy.
Okay, Latino.
If you have an adult and you can't explain the origin of the band, so for example, nicotinomania, lichen, psoriasis, tumor, because sometimes a Bowen and sometimes other type of tumor that can induce the pigmentation, you have to biopsy.
Okay. There is a question concerning confocal microscopy, but I can tell immediately, unfortunately, there is no indication for confocal microscopy because of the anatomic location. It doesn't allow.
Only during the operation.
I tried a lot of time, but it's impossible to see anything about the nail.
Only intraoperatively, only when you remove first the nail plate, then you can...
Yeah, the nail
as a dermoscopy, or you can look at the skin.
There is also a nice question concerning how long we perform follow up. So when it's the next visit, we usually do it every 6 months. But what is your way?
In my opinion, in my life, my consultation usually, if I see a patient with the single band without a history, but not so So a nice band with regular border, regular line, with regular parallelism inside the band and so on. I visit the patient the first time after 3 months, because a band never change in 3 months. If after 3 months is completely identical, you can see the patient after 6 and then after 8 and then you can have a longer period. If you have an explanation, okay, you can follow up directly the patient after 6. And if the obviously if the sign are not so nice, you have to perform biopsy. If the band is less than 3 millimeter, you can do punch biopsy. If the band is more than 3 millimeter, it is better to perform longitudinal biopsy. Yeah. But the problem of longitudinal is the scar.
Shape biopsy?
Tangential biopsy is the best. If you have a large lesion. You can cut away the lateral part of the proximal nail fold, and then you can cover, and then you tangential all the matrix, because it's a very shave. It's the possibility to have a scar is very, very low. And then you can have all the alteration of melanocytic in all the band. In this way, because on the punch you can select only a few part. If you have a large band, it's very not nice.
There is a very nice question concerning the because I showed before a case of onychomatricoma, and I said that we do follow up for a clear cut onychomatricoma, but Pascal is saying it will increase. So surgery is the action. What is your way of doing, Michela?
Usually when I do a diagnosis of onychomatricoma, and then the onychoscopy is perfect for diagnosis, I remove completely the lesion. I never do biopsy or never follow up, because it's in a very not short time, but it becomes very big, and then the surgery is not nice at the end, especially for the aesthetic result. So it's better to remove it when the lesion is not so large. No pain, no other problem.
If it's a benign lesion, it will stop growing anyhow.
No, it continues to grow.
Forever.
Not forever, for all of the nail unit.
for the entire nail unit?
Yes.
Really?
Yes, I remove two or three patients with the entire nail unit, and these start to be very thicker.
Uh-huh.
So you have to remove all.
What about onychopapilloma?
It's not nice, the result of the aesthetic after surgery.
What about onychopapilloma, which is also more frequent? Do you follow up? Do you do any
kind of... I do only follow up. Now, at the beginning, we remove it all, the onychopapilloma, especially for because there is some indication with the papilloma virus, and then the possibility to have as SCC. But now, no. The only problem of onychopapilloma is one is when it's pigmented, because you have to be very sure that it's onychopapilloma and not a band of melanonychia, and sometimes not so easy because it's completely dark. If you have the subungual filiformis at the end, it is very dark, so you cannot be so sure. And the other is malignant onychopapilloma. It is reported in this year with Matilde Iurizzo and Eckhardt Haneke. This is the most important histopathology of nail, the possibility of malignant. And you have suspect a malignant onychopapilloma when there is symptoms, because onychopapilloma never does any type of symptoms. But in case of the patient reports pain and other type of symptom, you have to suspect a malignant. So it is better to remove it. It's very, very rare.
I learned something there.
Yeah. I guess and I hope that this is very rare.
Very, very, very rare. Now it's only 2 cases reported in the world. I don't know in the past, because maybe it's impossible, but it's a very new entity. Malignant onychopapilloma, and we are scared everyone, because usually we lost.
Michela, can you clarify to Elisa, no scar with punch biopsy?
No scar. It's very easy. The punch biopsy nail, you have to use a larger punch with 4 millimeter, then you to remove all the nail plate. so in the punch site, then you use the 3 millimeter punch to remove the bed. For this reason, you can use this punch only if the lesion is less than 3 millimeter, because with the larger punch, the aesthetic result is not nice. So in this case, you have tangential, it's better.
Yeah.
It is no lesion. Then you have this hole, and then with the grow of the nail, go away.
Okay. Last question. Do you see sometimes complete regression of melanorrhea in child and in the adults? Yes, we do, especially in children. Not too much in adults, but in children many, many times. Yeah.
Yes, in children, okay. It's possible to have dark future or lighter future of the lesion. It depends on the child. It's not a problem. In adult, if there's a benign activation, you can, when you remove the cause that induced the activation, you can have a resolution sometimes.
Yeah.
For example, chemotherapy or the other.
Very good. Michela, can you imagine we had no chance to ask you the usual questions we ask to our guests, for example, how your life is going. But we have to ask a couple of questions, right, Emilio?
Yeah. Honestly, we did not stop asking, you know, for a moment.
Impressive. We never got so many questions like today. But a couple of questions for you, Michela. First of all, what is your the thing which is coming to your mind when you think about something successful in your professional life?
So the most successful, number one,
the thing coming to your mind.
I think it's sharing.
Sharing.
Yes, I love sharing. I love share all my experience with the other friends and the other experts. I love to perform paper about the collaboration. And I think all of you knows. And I love, because I think that the group at the end discovers so many things, so more things than the single. I love share.
I like it.
2021, and I hope more in the 2022.
I like very much this answer. We are on the same line. Emilio, it's for you the last question.
Michela, can you predict after 10 years from now, 15 years from now, the role of dermoscopy in the in dermatology?
I think that the role, I think it's not so, I think that the use of intelligence artificial with dermoscopy can help so much to improve the knowledge. In this case, I would like to use a non-invasive way to observe the metrics. I don't know why, I don't know where and when, but in my experience, this is, and also to have the avoid the invasive method to arrive at diagnosis. So for me, it's a scalp biopsy. It's not so difficult to perform it, but it's not nice for the patients. So my hope in the 10 years is to use a more technological part to avoid the invasive method. And if you have to remove it, it's okay. But in other case, only for diagnosis, I hope to remove it.
Very good, very good.
Michela,
one more. Yeah.
Which is your favorite wine?
My favorite wine is Ribolla Gialla.
Ah, your favorite wine is the same as Professor Zalaudek. Huh?
I think that we have the first wine here with two votes now.
Two votes for Ribolla Gialla. Very good.
Yes. One of my best.
Oh, very nice. By the way, we didn't launch the podcast because we had no time to do anything this time.
Oh, it's the past, the first.
Yes. We found one of your...
Yeah. This is my voice.
This is your voice.
You can use different instruments. For example...
I'm younger than...
How long ago did you perform this one?
I think 3 years ago.
3 years ago.
Yes, because last year I did another podcast about frontal fibrosing alopecia.
Okay.
Especially for the study about the AIDS.
I see. Very nice. Michela, thank you so much.
In this case, it's only scalp.
Yeah.
We need to do a podcast on nail.
Exactly. Yes.
Not one. More than one.
I think nails are not popular. It's an important role. It's a very specific. If you not do every day, it's a very a little bit part of the dermatology, I think. So for this reason, when you see a patient with a different, a difficult lesion, it's difficult to manage it.
Absolutely. Definitely.
Very good.
Michela, thank you so much.
Thank you too for the invitation. I'm so happy.
Have a nice evening. Enjoy. Un bacio. Ciao.
Wow. We are running today.
Wow. Incredible. We have to run to the Kahoot quiz.
Kahoot. Okay. I'm running. So, go, guys, we take our smartphones, and using our smartphones, we go to www.kahoot.it. And then this is the pin that you enter, and then we play for 5-6 minutes very, very quickly. We play the Kahoot of the week, in which I will show you 5 cases, one from each day of the previous week. And then we will have, you will vote, we will have the scores, we will have the winners, and we will have some fun in the end of this very nice episode. So please be as quick as possible, because we are already a little bit late today. Let's give 10 more seconds. 9, 8. Maybe, are you going to play? No.
Well, I would love to play, but I have told you.
Don't worry, the cases this week are not like the ones from last week.
They are easier than the last week.
They are, let's say, more reasonable.
Okay.
Okay, I would say we start in 3, 2, 1, and there we go.
Okay. I'm very curious.
So Monday, the week begins with this case.
Hmm.
You see?
Interesting.
An inflammatory lesion. I think it's feasible to answer.
It's feasible to answer.
I think so.
Yeah.
Let's see. Let's see what's going to happen. We didn't speak about it, of course, today, but the majority were able to answer correctly. Dermatitis, yellow crusts. Okay, great. So, and this is the classification according to the first answer. Victor is leading, but it's the very beginning. We have to clarify also that time matters, as you can see from the scores. So the difference here in the scores is a difference of speed in answering. Case of Tuesday case. Let's see. That's a little bit tricky.
Okay.
But feasible, I guess.
It's interesting because
your diagnosis was not included in the
exactly.
I know.
Okay. Melanoma definitely is the most voted one because it looks very, very ugly. But I thought about seborrheic keratosis, but lichen planus like keratosis.
Is there.
Okay. Nice. Yes.
Very good. It was a little bit challenging, but feasible. David comes in the first place, followed by Sid. Victor is still there in position number 3. Okay. Good. Wednesday case is somehow related to our discussion today, not nail part, but the tricuspid part. So areata, trichotillomania, lichen planopilaris, or discoid lupus erythematosus?
I'm not sure about two possibilities.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, 40-40.
maybe, chiaro. These were the two possibilities, yeah.
Great. Okay, areata with the exclamation mark here.
Yes.
Great, very good. And Kasia
is first.
Meeting. Great, Victor is still there. So
yeah. Victor is a marathon runner, you know, he's still there.
Nice, let's go to Thursday. Thursday case. Which is this one?
Ah, okay. Nice. Feasible.
Yeah. Maybe it's too easy and that might confuse some people. Let's see. Okay. Basal cell carcinoma.
Yeah.
Easy for the vast majority. Very good.
Okay.
Excellent. Kasia is on fire.
Yeah.
But look, it's so nice. Victor is still there fighting. This is
Penelope. Let me tell you, Penelope is not the first time that she's appearing here.
Of course. But imagine that this is among 150 people playing. And so it's nice. Yeah. Very nice. And the winner will be judged by the last case, which is the Friday case. So it's a little bit tricky. 6 years old acral site diagnosis.
When?
What? You stop smiling.
Well, I have one possibility.
Okay.
Nevus.
It was a little bit ugly nevus, but
if this is a 45-year-old man, this is definitely
no way. But even in a child, I showed it because the visit of Friday was the follow-up visit.
Yeah.
It was the third follow-up visit, and the lesion is stable, just growing just a little bit, but it's a child, so it's reasonable that it grows a little bit. Okay, so there we
go. Very good. Let's see the winner.
Podium. Place number three. Yumi.
Hey.
Number two, Kasia.
And
yes.
Grande Victor.
Oh, this was really a very well deserved victory for Victor.
Yes, Victor, you have to show up. Victor, open your camera. Victor, we want to see you.
So, Victor, please show. Victor, who are you? Sebastiano asks in the chat. Victor, who are you? So, Victor, if you are online, you are obviously online still. If you like, no JBCU tomorrow. Maybe Vittorio.
Ma Victor è Vittorio, il Vittorio mio. So maybe Victor is Vittorio, is one of our residents. Wow, he did a very good job.
But he doesn't want to show up.
He deserved to pass the exam, right?
Come on, Jeppy, that's already enough. What do you want more?
Bene. This was a very, very funny episode, let me tell you. We have really to thank Michela to have brought a lot of things. I learned, by the way, very few things, very nice things.
Here we are.
Vittorio is there
without the camera.
You know, Vittorio is a second year resident from Ischia, my favorite island near Napoli.
I've been there.
Yeah. And And I'm sure he's connecting from the island, right? Could be. Va bene. Okay. Anyhow, ragazzi, allora, it was very nice. Emilio.
Last thing, our YouTube channel, our episode will be there.
Yes.
As well as all the previous episodes. Please subscribe in the YouTube channel of the Dermoscopy Happy Hour and you will find all the material there. And join us next Sunday at 7 o'clock Central European Time.
Bene. Emilio, un bacione.
Ciao. Thank you very much.
Bye guys. Take
bye
care.
Bye Sebastiano.
Thank you. Ciao. We'll be right back.